Hi, this is Mike, alcoholic from Cleveland, Ohio. Today is August 11, 2018. I want to talk about step two. Here's step two. Came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. And for me, my sobriety date is July 1st, 1984, so I've been sober 34 years. To be restored to sanity for an alcoholic means that I don't pick up the first drink. And, you know, to believe in a power greater than myself, or willing to believe, is the step, basically. Here's a couple quotes from the big book, page 47. Do I not believe, or am I even willing to believe, that there is a power greater than myself? And that's a step two question. And yes, I do believe. And, you know, you hear in the meetings where people have been sober for a length of time, or, you know, they have a higher power, and they work with somebody and they share what their higher power is, and they describe it, and a person starting out would say, well, you know, I don't have any concept of higher power. Can I borrow your concept just to get a starting point? You can be willing to believe that I believe. To actually take that question and say, yes, I'm willing to believe that you believe in a higher power, something greater than yourself. My higher power is the spirit of the universe, unconditional love. And the second quote on page 53 in the book, big book, it says, when we became alcoholics crushed by self-imposed crisis, I could not postpone or evade. I had to fearlessly face the proposition that God is everything or else he is nothing. God is either is or he isn't. What was my choice to be? And I read that in first person. So, you know, when it talks about alcoholics being crushed by self-imposed crisis, it means that we did it to ourselves, that our drinking put us in a crisis. I had to fearlessly face the proposition that God is or he isn't. God is everything or he's nothing. So that's the second question for step two. And my answer would be, yes, God is everything. God is. That's basically taking step two, is to answer those two questions. And I'll say it again. First question is page 47. Do I not believe, or am I even willing to believe, that there is a power greater than myself? Second question, page 53. When we became alcoholics crushed by a self-imposed crisis we could not postpone or evade, we had to fiercely face the proposition that God is everything, or else he is nothing. God either is or he isn't. What was our choice to be? That's the two questions for step two. And just to flesh that out a little bit, to kind of have a broader understanding or deeper understanding of that, or step two, I go to Bill's story, page 12, where Ebby T comes to Bill and says to Bill, my friend suggested what then seemed like a novel idea. He said, why don't you choose your own conception of God? I could go for such conceptions as creative intelligence, universal mind, or spirit of nature, but it was only a matter of being willing to believe in a power greater than myself. Nothing more was required to make my beginning. So there was actually three quotes in there on page 12, kind of broken up in the page. But Ebby, his friend, suggested what it seemed like a novel idea. He says, why don't you choose your own conception of God? Now here is, in my opinion, the difference between religion and spirituality. My opinion, again, religion is you have a middleman between you and God. And I say that in all due respects, you know, preacher, priest, rabbi, you're having somebody interpret God for you, and you get it secondhand. In spirituality, you have an actual personal God of your own understanding between you and God. So there is no middleman. And that's my short version of religion and spirituality. Also, in spirituality, for me, it's 24/7, where I was raised Catholic as a kid, and I actually went to Catholic school to fifth grade and was taught by nuns back in the 60s, was taught Latin, went to Mass in the morning and all that, prayer and church. And I'm not disrespecting religion or anything, I'm just saying this is my experience. And I never really made a connection with a creator that created me, and it was personal to me. You know, Christ on the cross, I was just going through the motions. You know, it's just something they told me, and it's like, okay, this is what you believe, and this is what I'm supposed to believe also. And it really never made a connection for me, and I never really took it to heart, I guess. In spirituality, today in sobriety, my sobriety is contingent on my spiritual condition. When I reference 24/7, it's like when I wake up in the morning, I make a connection with my higher power, my God and my understanding, the spirit of the universe, and pray and meditate. And as I go through the day, it's God and I watching for self-will, you know, selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. It was basically a walking around step in step 10. So in the evening, I do my evening review, and step 11 has a series of questions. And it's kind of like a mini inventory. Step 10 is like a walking around mini inventory. Step 11 is in the evening, we review our day. So the point is, 24/7, it's like I have a conscious contact with God on a 24/7 basis, versus religion, where I as a kid would go to Mass for 2 hours and go through the motions, and it's like on the outside I'm being respectful and listening. And when I was going to school, you know, I would just go with the flow, right? But it's like in my lead, I would say I would go to Mass for 2 hours on Sunday, and then the rest of the week I'd be an SOB, and then 2 hours on Sunday I would do religion, and it's like go through these motions. And it was all fake, because I was running on self-will, never really connected with me. Grateful for the experience, to be exposed to that. It's important for me to acknowledge that. For some people, they have a bad experience with religion. Some people have a great experience with religion. In sobriety, it's spirituality for me. So in step 2, where it says restored to sanity, in my opinion, I believe it's in reference to picking up the first drink. And lately in my leads, you know, I would say, you know, everybody that's an alcoholic working a 12-step program, it's not drinking, has been restored to sanity by the mere fact that you have to recognize that you're not picking up the first drink. You're not picking up the first drink one day at a time. I have been restored to sanity, you know. And then on page 84 in the big book, it actually says, but the 10-step promises, which is our definition of our spiritual condition, on page 84 it says, we cease fighting anything or anybody, even alcohol. By this time, sanity has been returned. By working the steps 1 through 9, start practicing step 10, our sanity will be returned. And we cease fighting anything or anybody, even alcohol. By this time, sanity has returned. So in my mind, You know, we're not fighting anybody. Because for an alcoholic, for me as an alcoholic, to pick up the first drink is to start the physical phenomenon of craving. And I'm truly powerless. I can't control that. And the mental obsession that tells me it's okay to drink, I do believe in a power greater than myself. I have been restored to sanity because I'm not picking up the first drink. So it's so important to have a higher power. My higher power is the spirit of the universe, unconditional love. I use the example of, you know, when the sun comes up in the morning, it shines on the good, bad, and ugly. It's unconditional. And I try to practice that unconditional love and kindness. There's a prayer in there where it says, God, show me how to be patient and tolerant and kindly and loving. The spiritual life is not a theory. I have to live it. Thanks.